brings us to the next speaker in the program. That is Laura Starr. Laura Starr will discuss the value of insects for poultry. Laura is professor of precision feeding and sustainable poultry farming at the Aarhus University of Applied Sciences. And she's also a senior researcher poultry nutrition at Schothorst Feed Research here in the Netherlands.
Welcome, I'm Laura Starr. I have a background in poultry, and I'd like to tell you more about the value of insects for poultry. I think there are two interesting topics related to poultry. The first one is welfare. With insects or larvae, we can stimulate active behavior, natural behavior of the birds, and we might reduce feather pecking behavior. The other topic is nutrition. Larvae are very nutritious, they have a high fat and high protein level, and they might be of interest to at least partly substitute soybean meal, which is at the moment the main protein source in poultry diets. If we talk about welfare, we can think of feeding fresh larvae, and we need some lower volumes. Whereas if we talk about nutrition, we need processed larvae and we need much higher volumes. I like to discuss both topics, and I will start with welfare. In this picture, or in this sheet, you see two pictures. On the left, you see the one-day-old broiler chicks, and you already see that this small chick is eating a black soldier fly larvae. On the right picture, you see laying hens at the start of lay, and they have a tube, and in that tube are holes, and the tube is filled with black soldier fly larvae, and they have to pick out the black soldier flies from the tube, and it will take them a while before they have eaten all the larvae. So it stimulates the active behavior of the birds. And I like to continue on this trial. Here you see a picture, a table, and it shows the activity of the birds. We had two treatments. One was a control treatment that was fed a normal layer diet, and the other one was a larvae treatment. These birds also received a normal layer diet, but next to it, they received larvae in the tube with the holes. We measured the active behavior, or the behavior of the birds, let's say the activity of the birds, at 18, 28, and 36 weeks of age. And in active behavior, we measured walking, scratching, dust bathing, preening, so cleaning the feathers, eating and drinking. And the inactive behavior was resting and nesting behavior. And what you clearly see is that the control group, so the group that was not fed any larvae, they showed about during the period that we measured, that was 8 hours, they showed 70% active behavior and 30% inactive behavior, whereas the birds that received the larvae treatment in the tube, they showed at least 85% active behavior and 15 or less percent inactive behavior. We did also a trial on behavior and production performance together with Protix. In this, we had Protix developed a tube system where the larvae were gradually released from and felt on the floor space of the birds. And we measured here the production performance, but also some behavior and feather pecking or feather condition. And I'd like to show you more on that now. Here you first see two pictures on the right side. The most right picture is a picture of the treatment with the tube system. And here in that picture, you also see that a lot of birds are on the floor area around the tubes. In the left picture, you see the control treatment, and most of the birds are on the sleds or on the perches. And what we did, we simply scored how many birds were on the floor or on the sled or perches. And we did that in the morning for a half hour before and a half hour after. We fed the birds the larvae, and we did it for an hour in the afternoon. And we did it at the beginning. So as you can see in the graph, it was in January 2019, and we did it in April 2019. And that was the start and the end of the trial. And you clearly see that in the morning, when around that we feed the larvae, that's at the moment that the point that's indicated by the red arrow, you see that there's more active behavior in the birds that are fed the larvae, or at least active behavior. There are more birds on the floor around the tubes, whereas in the afternoon, it's more the opposite, and the birds of the control treatment showed more behavior on the ground area. What we also did in this trial was we scored the feather condition of the birds. We scored the head, the neck, the back, the rump, and the belly of the birds. And if they have perfect feathers, we score a zero. And if they have a large denuded area, we score that with a four. And if it's totally denuded, it was even a five. And what you can see is that the feather condition of the birds, we did it, we measured it at 67 and at 81 weeks of age. And at 67, the birds were already, the feather condition was already poor. And that's something we often see in older birds. So it was no surprise. But what was a surprise, that was really interesting, is that at 81 weeks of age, we saw that the feather condition of the birds was improved. Normally we see that it becomes worse when birds become older, but in this case we saw that in both the control as in the larvae treatment, we saw that the feather condition was improved, but the larvae treatment was more improved than the control treatment. So that was very interesting. Then we also looked to the feed intake of the birds. For the feed intake, it's good to know that we fed the control birds a normal layer diet, and the larvae treatment was fed a diet without soybean meal. The nutrient composition of the diets was similar, and the larvae treatment, besides the free available layer diet, they received the larvae, and that was about 10% of their daily ration. So 12 grams per hen per day was fed as larvae. And what you see is that the feed intake was reduced by 10 grams per hen per day, and that's really a lot. And especially if you think that they received 12 grams of larvae, which is mostly water, it indicates that the birds first adapted their feed intake to the larvae that they were fed, but also that the larvae were very nutritious for the birds. Yeah, I shortly like to show you the composition, the nutrient composition of black soldier fly meal related to soybean meal. You can find several articles about this topic, but I choose this one because it shows a partly defatted and a highly defatted black soldier fly meal. And I don't like to go all details, but I like to show you that the eater extract, so that's the fat level of the BSF meal, is very high if it's only partially defatted, and it's already much lower if you highly defat the BSF meal. But even then, the fat content is higher than that of soybean meal. And also the crude protein level of the soybean meal is lower than the highly defatted BSF meal. And if you look to the amino acid pattern that's given in the right table, then you see that in the highly defatted BSF meal, that the lysine content is similar to that of the soybean meal, whereas the arginine level is slightly lower, but the isoleucine, methionine, threonine, and valine, those are higher for the BSF meal, and then the highly defatted BSF meal compared to soybean meal. And this shows that the BSF meal might be a good substitute for soybean meal. At least it can be partly substitute the soybean meal. The nutritious level of the BSF depends, however, on the life stage of the insect, of the larvae. That's shown here in these three graphs. The first is the dry mass. In the middle, you see the crude protein content of the individual BSF larvae. And on the right, you see the crude protein level of crude protein content. And for all, you see that the early pre-pupa stage, that the dry mass is highest in that stage. Also, the fat content is highest, and the crude protein content is slightly higher in the early pupa stage, but it's closely followed by the early pre-pupa stage. So this indicates that from a nutritious point of view for poultry, it is of most interest to harvest the larvae at the early pre-pupa stage. The nutrient content of the larvae also depends on the substrate that you feed them, and that's nicely shown in this sheet. It's a study done by an applied university in the Netherlands, Haas Hogeschool, and they fed the birds, they fed the insects organic waste or swill. They also used the black soldier fly larvae. And in the left graph, you clearly see that on organic waste, so only vegetable and fruits, they grow much slower than on swill. And swill also included, besides the vegetables and fruits, it also included meat. And what's even more of interest, besides the growth rate, is the composition of the black soldier flies. If you look to the organic waste, they have about 39% crude protein. But the fat content is only 12%, whereas if you feed the larvae swill, you see that the crude protein is about 37%, so quite comparable to the organic waste, but the fat level is 34.6%, so that is much higher on the swill than on organic waste. So that really will affect the nutritive value of the insects, and also how you have to validate it for validate it for your poultry diet. So, from a nutrition point of view, insects are very interesting for poultry. Besides that, they love it. It's also a good nutrient, they contain good nutrients. But there are unfortunately some buts. The first is that protein of processing is required, because if we like it as to use as a feedstuff, we need a dried content. So we need an insect meal or an insect protein or insect fat. And here legislation is an issue, because the insect meal and insect protein are not allowed at the moment to use in poultry diets. We are not allowed to use processed animal proteins, and unfortunately insects are under this law, so that has to be changed first. Besides, we need high and constant quantities if we use it in the poultry diets. We need large volumes. And we have to know how the poultry will digest the different insect meals, insect proteins, and also the different qualities that we will see. And by that we can estimate digestibility coefficients, and with the digestibility coefficients, the feed mills can calculate the poultry diets or formulate the poultry diets. Another thing is that we can grow the larvae on waste materials, and that is very interesting, especially in a circular economy. The insects can be used to close some loops in the circular economy. I think we have to be aware that if we use waste materials, that we will get lower quality insects. And it should not be a problem, but we have to be aware of that. And at the moment, also here, legislation is an issue because we are not allowed to grow insects on waste materials and feed those insects to poultry. From a welfare point of view, also here, insects are of interest, especially fresh larvae are of interest. And luckily, there's no issue with legislation if we like to feed fresh larvae. We can use less nutritious larvae if we only use it from a welfare point of view. And we can also use lower volumes because it's just to include, to spread some larvae in a layer house or a broiler house to stimulate the activity of the birds. So if you use 2 or 3%, that will be enough. Whereas if you talk about included in really in the poultry diet, you have to think of 5 to 10% of the poultry diet that will be based on the insect meal or insect proteins. So much higher volumes are needed there. And I like to end this presentation with a quote by Arnold van Huys. Arnold van Huys is professor at Wageningen University. And he stated that if 1% of the poultry feed will be substituted by insects, you need approximately 140,000 ton. This shows the enormous potential. And I totally agree with Professor Arnold van Huys. And hereby I like to end my presentation. Thank you for your attention. And if you have any questions, please feel free to contact me.
Hello, Laura. That was a great presentation. Thank you for that. We have lots of questions coming in again. The chat is going wild. I will have to make a selection. This one to start with. Are these results also relevant for broilers?
Interesting question. It is, yeah. In my presentation, I mainly focused on laying hens. But in one of the slides, I also showed a picture of a one-day-old chick with a BSF larvae. And at that age, they can also already consume the larvae, and they really enjoy it. If as soon as you spread the larvae in the broiler house, they immediately go for it and search for the larvae. So they really like it. So from also from a welfare point of view, you can use it for the broilers. But also if as soon as it is allowed in the EU, it's also of interest to use the insect meal or the insect proteins for the broilers, because the broiler diets, they contain even more protein than the layer diet. So if you can use it to substitute soybean meal, or at least partly, or use another protein source to help the growth of the birds, then it will be great if we can do that. Yeah.
Okay, great, thank you. This one is also interesting, I think. What is the natural diet of chickens?
Yeah, in nature, they eat everything. So they eat leaves, seeds, grains, but also insects. They like to scratch and search for food. So everything that they see, if it's a small beetle or a spider or a worm or a larvae, they will eat it. Yeah.
They really eat from all sources.
They are omnivores, so they eat everything. Yeah,
they're not vegetarians by nature, then, huh?
No, for sure not. No.
And then this question, I like this one. Is it already in practice? Are there already eggs in store from chicken fed with larvae?
Yeah. At least I don't know how it is in other countries, but I know in the Netherlands we have one egg, het oerei, and that's you can buy it in the supermarkets.
Yeah. I like the question. And indeed, there was also somebody asking, and where is it also in other countries? But that's... Then how about this one, the egg micronutrient composition? Was the egg micronutrient composition also altered, and did you measure the cholesterol level in the egg?
No, we didn't. We looked for egg quality, but that was mainly related to the eggshell. If that was affected, and the Hawk unit, so the thickness of the egg white, and the Hawk unit as well as the eggshell, they were not affected by the by feeding the larvae, so there was no difference with the control treatment. We did not look for the micronutrients, and also not for cholesterol. But I can imagine that at least certain fatty acids from the black soldier fly, that you can find them back in the that pattern, at least from the black soldier fly, that you can find it back in the egg yolks, because that's one of the few things in the egg that you really can change by feed. So that are the fatty acid pattern that you can affect that. But for all other micronutrients, the chicken tries to keep it as much stable as possible, because it's, we consume it, but originally it's to grow an embryo and a small chick. So the bird will try to keep it as the nutrients in the egg as similar as possible.
Scrolling down to some of the more recent questions here. Talking about the regulatory approval. So could you perhaps give some updates on the regulatory approval of insect proteins in poultry feed?
Yeah, I'm not involved in the discussions at the EU level. So I also hear it from the field. I think, a lot of people expected that around this time we would have approval to use it in poultry and also in pigs, because 3 years ago it was already approved for use in aquaculture. So everybody thought, okay, then it will speed up, and also for poultry and pigs it will be available soon. But still at the moment it's not allowed, but still good hope at least that next year or at least within 2 years that it will be approved and that we can use the insect meal and insect protein also for in poultry and pig diets.
And these are always long processes, huh?
Very hard.
Okay, well, thank you, Laura, for sharing your knowledge. It was a pleasure listening to you.
Thank you. Nice to join.